there shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above.
Will you join in the congregational prayer as we pray together? Gracious God and most merciful Father, we come before you, not only asking for the blessings that we desperately need today, whether it be for rain, health, finances, companionship, comfort, or peace. We come also giving back to you our first fruits, whatever that may look like. We gladly give of our time, our talents, and our resources, our love, grace, and patience, asking that you would use these gifts that you have given us as a way to give back to you. Thank you for allowing us to be a part of your grand design, and we ask that you would rid our hearts of any pride, malice, greed, or selfishness.
Amen.
As the deacons prepare to take up the offering, I'm reading from the Jesus Calling book. Stay calmly conscious of me today, no matter what. Remember that I go before you as well as with you into each day. Nothing takes me by surprise. I will not allow circumstances to overwhelm you so long as you look to me. I will help you cope with whatever the moment presents. Collaborating with me brings blessings that far outweigh all your troubles. Awareness of my presence contains joy that can endure all eventualities. And that's from Psalms and 1 Corinthians. And as always, thanks. Give thanks to God for his good because his steadfast love endures forever.
Up after Pentecost and after we've looked at many
many times were after the disciples went out, and then we looked at Peter and John healing the man with the lame arm or that arm. And now this is what happens after more and more believers have come into the fold. It says, but there was a man named Ananias with the consent of his wife, Sapphira, sold a piece of property with his wife's knowledge, and he kept back some of the proceeds. He brought only a part and laid it at the apostles' feet. Ananias, Peter asked, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back part of the proceeds of the land? Well, it remained unsold. Did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, were not the proceeds at your disposal? How is it that you have contrived this deed in your heart? You did not lie to us, but to God. Now when Ananias heard these words, he fell down and died. And great fear seized all who heard of it. Then the young men came and wrapped up his body, and then carried him out and buried him. After an interval of about 3 hours, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. Peter said to her, tell me whether you and your husband sold the land for such and such a piece. And she said, yes, that was the price. Then Peter said to her, how is it that you have agreed together to put the Spirit of the Lord to test? Look, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out. And immediately she fell down at his feet and died. When the young men came in and found her dead, they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. And great fear seized the whole church and all who heard these things. Thus ends the reading. Thanks be to God.
I have got some money. What have I got here? I got a dime, I got two pennies, and a quarter. So we're going to... Yes, 37 cents. So we're going to put that in there. Now, when we just read this story, it said some people had some money, and they told God they were going to give God the money. But when they came and they gave the money to the disciples, there wasn't anything in there. And they talked about it. And then they showed up, and how much did they have? 37 cents. So what have I got now?
25.
Now I got 27 cents. I got 27 cents. Well, we started with 37 cents, and now we got 27 cents. Is that the same? Yep. What happened to 10 cents, right? They kept it back. Kept it back in their house for like a rainy day in case they might need it. Now, we're going to get into the story a little more. It may sound a little odd, but there's way more to the story than what most people think when they hear it. So what the problem was, what happened to the people? Did you catch that?
They died.
They died. That's right. And was Peter saying that he was mad at them? Had they really lied to the disciples, or who did they lie to? The Holy Spirit. Very good. And God... There's another key mystery in that with the Holy Spirit. So you guys are going to have to listen really good, because I'm going to answer some really cool questions that most people don't know. So then you can be all wise and you can tell them. Okay? There is a difference. When we tell God we're going to do something, should we do it? That's pretty serious, isn't it? It's like making an oath. So it's important that when you tell your folks you're going to do something, to do it. But when you tell God, see, these people didn't have to give anything to God. God didn't say, I want you to sell that land and give me the money. God didn't say that at all. They put in their heart, they wanted to be proud, and they wanted to show everybody that they were going to do this thing. So they decided they were going to sell the land, and they were going to give all the money to God's work. That was great. God was tickled to death. But then, at the last minute, they decided to hold some back. So we're going to give God almost all of it, but not all of it. That is where they, and then they lied about it. Even the wife, when they came, they said, so if they sold the property for $100, and they family showed up with 85, and then the disciples said, did you sell it for 85? And she goes, oh yes, we sold it for 85. But how much did they really sell it for?
100.
So there was a double lie. And Peter says, you weren't lying to us. You were lying to God. And that's not cool. Because does God know when you're lying? Oh yes, he does. He does. So he always gives us opportunities to tell the truth. He gives us opportunities to do the right thing. And he gives us lots of opportunities. He gives us lots of opportunities to show others. But when you give something to God, you need to give it with all your heart. It's a hard thing, isn't it? If you do it cheerfully. That's a penny, didn't you? Well, guess what? I don't have a bunch of pennies to give you, but what I do have, what is it Peter said? I don't have silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. Yeah. Oh, your sister went back. You want to come get it?
Look. Oh. Say thank you.
Tell you what. There's a gal sitting, come here. But we ask that you lead with our heart and you would let us do it joyfully, and that when we decide to do something, that we carry through with it. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay? Nobody much reads from that passage, do they? How many were sitting there kind of squirming and a little uncomfortable at that? Well, you should be, but there's so much more to that little story than what anybody even realizes. Okay, if you remember, this is, as I said, it was right after the apostles were going out in Jerusalem and they were converting people. And it said thousands were being baptized and thousands were coming into the fold. That was good. Now, what you may not know is Ananias and Sapphira, those are Roman names. They're not Jewish. Not a big deal. But what was their background? We don't know that they were Jewish Romans. In fact, when the Holy Spirit was speaking to everybody who had come into Jerusalem that day, what were the men saying? How is it these fishermen are hearing or speaking it in our language? People from all over, and they were speaking 14 different languages. Sharing the gospel message. Now, I have not 100% backing on this, other than I will say it was a download last night from the Holy Spirit. But as I was pondering this and thinking it, a whole new line came to me. With them being Roman, they would have been exposed to what? How many gods would they have been worshiping? Lots, right? They were not worshiping Adonai, the Jewish God. They were worshiping all sorts of gods. And when you do that, you had to bring sacrifices to them, or you had to pray to them, or you had to do all this stuff. But if they're not real, what were the consequences? If you decided to hold back a little portion to Zeus or Aphrodite or Jupiter or Saturn or whoever you were doing it to, what really was the consequence? Yeah. So what sets God apart from all these other spirits? Our God is all-powerful, right? It was a heart thing. Now you also have to realize that if they were Roman and they were new believers in Christ, who were the new believers? They were the new ministers that were going to be going out and spreading that gospel message. And God purposely picked people from different regions and different languages to then go and spread the gospel to those people. So if you have Romans who have now converted to Christianity, who are they let's say, let's whittle this down to them being ministers. If you have ministers who are going to be in charge of a new congregation, and their heart was still divided between the gods they worshiped and this newfound God. If you had ministers who were like, yeah, we're in, but we're not really all in. Yeah, we've heard some really good stuff and felt some warm fuzzies in our heart, but you know, maybe I should keep some of that money for a rainy day, just in case this doesn't pan out. We've seen this before. How would you like that pastor up here preaching to you? We think it's a good thing, but, you know, this may wane, and then, well, that's what was going on. So, again, as I told the kids, when Ananias and Sapphira decided to do this, God didn't ask them. The disciples did not come to them and say, hey, we know you have some land. Why don't you go sell it? There is a parallel here, because there is a young rich man who Jesus actually told them to. If you remember the story of the young rich man who came to Jesus and said, sir, what must I do to inherit the kingdom of God? And what does Jesus say? Knowing that where his heart was at, it was in all of his stuff. He owned a lot of stuff. And he said, what must you do? You must go and sell all of your possessions. Give it to God. And then follow me. What happened to the young man? Did he do it? No. He said he hung his head in shame and he turned around and he walked away. It wasn't because God was saying, in order for you to follow me, you can't have anything. That was not it. It was a heart thing. He says, where your treasure is where your heart is. Where your heart is where your treasure is. It's the same thing. That man walked away. So here we have Ananias and Sapphira. What must they do? Well, in their mind, they're thinking, I'm going to sell this to help broaden the ministry, to help fill up the first fruits. Great. But then when they sold it, we'll say, for 100 denarii at the time, but they kept some of it back. They said they only sold it for 85. And they brought 85 as a big show to the disciples. Look what we did. We sold our property and were laid at the feet of this newfound God. Bringing 85 denarii, was that a bad thing? No, it wasn't. Peter even says that. He asks him, he goes, you said, now here's the thing. Peter knows this because of a download from the Holy Spirit. He didn't know that they were going to sell it. He didn't know what they sold it for. He finds out that they're withholding money. And he says, you didn't lie to us. He makes that very clear. He says, you lied to who? God. God knows. See, here's already a separation. Your gods don't know. But our God does. And you don't make an oath to our God and take it lightly and try to lie to him and try to swindle him. It was a trust thing to him. See, we see that throughout all the Old Testament. That's why I like to start back with Abraham, because it was a trust thing. Abraham and his entire family followed the other gods, and when Adonai came and grabbed him and said, I am going to make a great nation from you, it was a trust thing. You need to follow me. I will bless you if you devote yourself to me. These new disciples, apostles that were converting people, it was the same thing. You need to trust me, God's saying, and I will bless you. The disciples were not the ones saving people. They were not the ones converting people. They were the ones that were the instrument that was spreading the gospel message, and God was the one touching the heart and doing the saving and doing the converting. Changing radically the way that they had lived, the way that they had thought, into this whole new way of thinking. God was literally trying to show these people, like he did Abraham, try me, test me, see that I won't be faithful, don't withhold anything. And Abraham didn't even withhold his own son, did he? It was a trust thing. God was removing him from an old life into a new life that he was going to be richly blessed. So we see what happens when Ananias, he still follows through with this whole plan. It says the minute he did that and Peter convicts him, it says he drops down dead. Now his wife was not with him at the time. I kind of wonder about this a little bit, because Sapphira, and again, this is one of those, you just have to trust that God knew her heart and what was going on. Because if she was in on the plan, she might have felt like, well, I can't tell the truth because I was told that I have to do this. But I don't think so. I think from the very beginning, they were both conniving. Because they asked her then point blank. They didn't say, oh, thank you for your donation. Oh, thank you for your generosity. They said, how much did you sell that land for? What was the price? And she says, 85. And then they say the same thing. Well, and they tell her what happened to her husband. They said, because he lied, you're going to follow in the same fate as him. Again, it was a hard thing. And it was a huge demonstration to all the other believers around. You don't mess with our God. He knows all things. You can't lie to him and think you can get away with it. So let me ask you here. This might be touching a little closer to home than you maybe squirm a little bit, but who here has ever lied to God? Did you think he didn't know? Who here has ever said, I promise I will never, ever, ever, if only you? That's human nature, right? But who are we fooling? We're only fooling ourselves. And anybody who might be watching. Again, this was a trust thing. This was a rebuilding. For these people, as I said, Ananias and Sapphira were probably thinking they were in, but they weren't all in. This sounds like a really good deal, but sometimes what? If it's too good to be true, it usually is, except when God is involved. So maybe we'll just take it back a little in case this doesn't go good, and then, you know, nobody else is doing that. Nobody else is being smart enough and thinking about themselves, because what if this all goes wrong? What are they going to have to live on? Did you see what Malachi said? And Malachi says, try me, test me, see that I am good, see that I will not provide. How's that working in your life right now? You know, a lot of people are like, oh, stewardship sermon. No. Peter says, give that which God has given you abundantly, whatever that looks like. If he has blessed you with a lot of talent, what are you doing with that talent? Not just for church, but for God. If he has blessed you with unbelievable intellect, what are you doing with that? Are you just sitting home watching Jeopardy? If he has given you money, that is awesome. There are so many people that have been very blessed with that. But what is the scripture also saying? He who has been given much is what? Expected much. Right? He who has been given will be given more, but there's a price to that, or it will be taken away. Jesus was constantly giving parables about that. He's not saying you have to give everything up, but what are you doing with the money that you have? I love those lottery stories, right? I mean, they're sad, but I love the ones that show that when people had a good concept and they had a good heart thing going before they ever won the lottery didn't affect them. The first thing they were thinking was, oh my gosh, who can I bless him? Who can I give this to? Who can I help out? It's a hard thing. And the ones begin before they have it, what usually happens to them afterwards? Their lives are destroyed. It's worse than it was before they won. It has nothing to do with money. It has everything to do with heart. So what I want you to take away from this is the scripture that's in your bulletin. God says, try me and test me. It's a trust thing. Who are you putting your trust in? When you've told God, and maybe you've done that, have you ever been somewhere, or maybe even the church was trying to raise money for something, or maybe it was at the end of the year, and you're going, what should I give? And you're sitting there thinking about it. How many people here have a number that just pops in your head? Maybe I'm the only one. Every time I think about giving to anything, even if it's somebody standing on the street corner, I ask, am I supposed to? And if so, then I say, how much? And there is always a number that pops into my head. Maybe big, maybe small, but it's a number. That's not random. That's from the Holy Spirit. What do you do with that when you have that number? See, they were lying to the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit says, I want you to give $20, and you go, yeah, but I got lunch coming up, and I got, you know, something else. I might need that extra money. How about if I give them 15? Maybe 10. Maybe 10 would be good, because I don't know what they're going to use that money for. See, we start rationalizing things in our head, right? Now, thankfully for all of us, we haven't dropped down dead when the Holy Spirit has given us a number. We've gotten grace. But who are we not trusting? It's God. If God says, give $20 to whatever it is, did you ever stop to think that if everybody did exactly what he said, that would be exactly the amount of money that was needed for whatever? It's trusting. And maybe it goes the other way. Maybe you're thinking a higher number. And God knows the full picture. He knows that there's going to be 50 people that are going to be chipping in, and you don't have to give that much. He goes, you only have to give $5 to $10. Again, what's it about? Is it a hard thing? It's, well, if I was going to give 100 and I want them to know I was going to give 100, that looks pretty impressive, doesn't it? As opposed to if I were to give 10. Then I just wanted the numbers. It goes all different directions. All different directions. So give me a lot to chew on. A lot to go home and think about. But my challenge is, do a heart check. We go to the doctor all the time to have a heart, physical heart check. Go to the great physician. Have a spiritual heart check. And ask that the next time the opportunity presents itself, that God would open your ears to the Holy Spirit's calling, and that he would give you the courage to trust him with whatever the answer may be. Amen. So we come to our time of prayer. I know we've had lots of people here in town for Aurora Days. Class reunions. We also have had people in the hospital. Connie's doing better. And did she get to come home then? At that time. We'll continue to pray for her. Are there others that we'd like to lift up? You bow your heads with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today, and there are so many on our hearts and minds, those that have been mentioned and those that you know who they are. There are those who are struggling right now with, maybe it is finances. Maybe they just don't know how they're going to meet the end of the month. Maybe there are those that are faced with so many health decisions that they've just thrown up their hands and they're desperately praying for an answer. Maybe there are those who are right now struggling with just listening to your voice. Am I really hearing you? Dear Lord, we just pray that you would put on each person's heart a sense of increased trust an increased faith, and an increased desire to do your will, even if it goes against what maybe we think we should do. Thank you so much for these stories in the Bible, and while some are very serious, you still continue to give us grace. And you demonstrate that you are Lord of all lords, King of all kings, God of all. And when we make a promise to you, we really need to take it seriously. And we thank you for your Son, who gave us so many stories and so many parables, but he also gave us a prayer that we could pray to you. If you would join with me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. As we come to Christ's feast that is open and inviting to all, we come remembering Jesus sitting with his disciples, and one of them's heart was not in the right place. And yet, Christ still invited him to the table. He lifted up that loaf, he gave thanks, he blessed it, and he broke it. And he said, this is now going to be my body, which will be broken for you. Even the one that was about to be tried. Every time you read this, do this in remembrance of me. And then he picked up the cup of salvation. He said, this is now going to be a new covenant, a covenant between myself and you. It'll be my blood which will be poured out for the forgiveness of all sin. Every time you drink of this, do this in remembrance of me. And so as the body of Christ, we come before his table, partaking of the elements, remembering that we are forgiven, even if our heart needs a good checkup. And then he asks us to go out and tell everyone else that good news. If you would join with me in our next hymn, Bind Us Together, I think it's page 21.
In Christ's name, in the celebration of his birth, we pray this prayer. Amen.
your table as one people, gracious God. When we drink this cup, we are reminded that in Christ's self-sacrificing love, all the barriers that would separate us have been broken down. Because of Christ on the cross, your love has proven stronger than any human fear and hostility. In times when we feel separated from your love, empower us by your Spirit to ask for and receive your holy love. Then enable us to break down the barriers that separate others from you, so that we may affirm that we are one in Christ's Spirit around the world forever.
Blessings on you. He just asks you to trust him and to share those blessings with others.